Welcome to Car Corner. My name's Richard Saxton. I'm the coordinator of the automotive programs here at the Community College of Philadelphia. In today's episode, you're going to see Dan Reed talk about fuel systems on your car. If you have any questions about our programs, please check us out on the web. Thanks, and have a great day.
Hi, I'm Dan Reed with the Community College of Philadelphia's Automotive Technology Program. Welcome to Car Corner. Today, we're going to be talking about something that's on everybody's mind these days, which is gasoline. And I think there's some confusion at first of what gasoline actually is and where it comes from and, you know, more importantly, why does it cost so much money and why do we use it as a fuel? And I hope to explain a little bit of that. First and foremost, gasoline starts out as crude oil. Now, you've probably heard that term before, crude oil. And crude oil is what it sounds like. It's crude oil. It's impure oil. And the oil comes from deep underneath the Earth's crust. And it's essentially, it's a fossil fuel, which means that it's made up of broken down plants and animal matter, yes, dinosaurs and everything, from millions and millions of years ago, packed layer upon layer of heat and pressure that's actually basically liquefied all that plant and animal matter into a crude oil. Now the oil, when it's crude oil, may contain things like a lot of water and sludge, tars, all those types of things. But the main building blocks of hydrogen and carbon, which we later distill into hydrocarbons for gasoline, is why it's so useful. And the fact is the crude oil in itself, it really has to be purified and cleansed before it actually becomes gasoline. Now, as a rough rule, depending on the volume of crude oil we start out with, generally if we have a 42-gallon barrel, which is the size of a barrel of crude, we end up with about half of that volume. So somewhere, depending around, we'll get about 20 gallons, maybe a third of that will actually be able to be converted into gasoline. Now, some crude oil, obviously, there's a lot in here. On a good day, we'll be able to convert about half of it. But you have to realize that all of our other petroleum products that we use in modern life, like kerosene and diesel fuel, even asphalt, roofing tar, plastics, they all come from this crude oil. And gasoline makes up a fraction of what we get out of that crude oil. Now, the way that we get it is we actually heat the crude oil through a type of distilling process, which is actually the same way that we distill grain into alcohol or other things like potatoes or rice or other types of liquids that we ferment into alcohol. And the actual fermentation and distillation process, or rather the distillation process, is actually how we get our fuel converted into gasoline. So we start out with the crude and we wind up with the gas. Now the chemical symbol for gasoline here is 8 carbons and 18 hydrogens, so it's a hydrocarbon, and it burns very well. All living things are made of hydrogen and carbon, and so yes, this used to be living things. So when you hear something on the news about an oil rig and there's a oil spill in the middle of the ocean, you got to realize that that oil rig is literally tapping down beneath Earth's crust, maybe miles and miles deep, to extract this crude oil out of the ground so it can later be processed into fuel. Now, there's a lot of countries that have a lot of crude oil underneath our feet. United States has some, obviously the Middle East has some, but there's some in Russia and China and Australia. Fact is there's crude oil pretty much everywhere underneath the planet, and sometimes getting to it can be a little difficult. But the fact is that the price of the crude oil really dictates the price of gasoline. And you got to realize, you can't think of gasoline as a domestic or an import product necessarily. You almost have to think of it as gold. It's pretty much a global standard of what it costs at any moment. And much like the gold market, there's a lot of forces that act upon it and make the price go up and down. Obviously, it's crude oil is a non-renewable resource. The problem is scientists don't exactly know exactly how much is underneath our feet, we have a good idea, but we're not making any more of it anytime soon. It would take, again, millions and millions of years to actually make this this product. So, you know, we are going to run out of it someday, so we better have something good lined up behind it. And the fact is that a lot of the current market-driven pricing of the cost of this is the fact that other developing countries are starting to drive cars. You have places like China and India, which have huge populations of people that are starting to become basically middle-class citizens, and they want to drive cars. And because of that, hey, now we got customers in China and India that we can sell our product to, and that actually raises the price up because there's only so much of this stuff to go around. And now more people want it, so the demand's gone up, and that's driven the price up. Now what I did is I went online and I located this nifty infographic, and this is actually from the U.S. Energy Information Administration. This is a government publication. That's the website there, EIA.gov. And they have this great infographic that actually changes every month. It's updated every month, and it shows you what percentage of a price per gallon of gasoline costs. This one is was the U.S. average back in February of 2012. And gas back then was about $3.60 a gallon. Now, the price difference between, say, Pennsylvania and New Jersey, you know, the fact is the basic feedstock gasoline is the same between the two states, but the amount of taxes that Pennsylvania charges per gallon is actually higher than New Jersey, which is why the gas is cheaper in New Jersey than it is in Pennsylvania. But we can see that 72% of the actual price that goes into a gallon of gas is based upon the price of crude oil. Now, the price of crude oil goes up and down every day in the markets, and that's why the prices change every day up and down in the markets. Some of the market pricing is driven by speculation. Some of it's driven by geopolitical instability. If there's a war or unstable political environment in a country that is a major contributor to the world supply of oil, that's going to create some price differences in there. We can see that refining the oil is about 12%, and that's the process of actually converting the crude oil into gasoline. Then we have distribution and marketing, and that's taking that truck that fills up at the fuel depot, maybe down in South Philadelphia, and then bringing it to the gas station and then marketing that, you know, the signs, the gas station ads, and things like that. And then, of course, 11% might be federal and state taxes. The federal government takes a cut, and then also the state government takes a cut. That money, those taxes per gallon, are actually then put back into the state and international infrastructure system to fix things like bridges and roads. So when you buy fuel, those taxes that you pay are actually going back into things like fixing the roads and other types of infrastructure like that. So, you know, people often complain about the price of fuel, and it is expensive, and it's certainly not going to get any cheaper anytime soon. But it is important to understand that the money just doesn't all go back to the gas station, or it doesn't all go back to the oil company. It's distributed throughout lots of different businesses. And frankly, to get this oil out of the ground is a very dangerous and expensive job, and then converting it from the crude oil into our gasoline is also dangerous and expensive. Okay, so the gasoline itself, this is the natural color of gasoline. It sort of has a little bit of almost like a light apple juice color to it. Some manufacturers will actually dye the gasoline different colors to dictate, to show that it's one type of octane rating is more potent than other types of fuels. But when you are working with fuel systems, a couple things come to mind. First and foremost, you want to make sure that you have a good pair of safety glasses. When I go to open the fuel system of the car, I'm going to make sure I have my glasses on. And that way I don't get any fuel splashed in my eyes. Obviously, that would be painful. The other thing is it's a good idea to protect yourself with a pair of rubber gloves. Technically, they're not rubber. These are actually a chemical compound called nitrile, which resists petroleum products. So if you do wear rubber rubber latex gloves and you get gasoline on them, the rubber will actually break down. Gasoline is actually quite corrosive to some metals and a lot of plastics, and if you're going to transport gasoline, you have to make sure you have it in a proper approved container. Now, this is a plastic container, but it's marked gasoline and it's designed to resist gasoline from melting the plastic. And just to give you a quick demo of how destructive gasoline can be, I have a styrofoam cup. And styrofoam is one of those products that actually gets broken down very easily by gasoline. Now, I've seen some people do some pretty foolish things, and they might run out of gas, and they might go, and they might get an empty gallon milk jug or something like that to fill the car back up with. That's a bad idea, because the fact is the plastic the milk jug is made out of may actually be something that's not safe for gasoline. So if I pour this in to this cup, I'm just going to pour a little bit in here. It literally will start to eat the plastic cup away, the styrofoam cup away here. There it goes. Yep, there goes all my gasoline out there at the bottom. And this cup can pretty much just be compressed down as the gasoline eats away. Look at that. It is just disintegrating nicely. Leave this here long enough and there won't be any cup left. There's what's left of the plastic cup. It's kind of like flammable taffy at this point. There is my plastic cup. And that's why you don't store it in your plastic styrofoam cups there. So now that we know a little something about gasoline and where it comes from and how to be safe with it, let's take a look at some of the fuel system components in our vehicle. So what I've got here is a fuel tank out of a late 80s GM product, and this is pretty typical of what a modern-ish design fuel tank is. It's made out of steel. It's made out of steel that is electroplated with special corrosion-resistant material. This kind of helps prevent rust from forming inside the tank if we get moisture in there. Just realize that, you know, nothing is perfect. If you dump something like salt or bleach or something, some really harsh chemical in the fuel tank, it's going to cause a problem. One myth of the damaging fuel systems is that if you dissolve or pour sugar in the gas tank, you would literally have to put pounds of sugar in a gas tank. And I'm some people think if you just put a little bit in there, it's going to cause a problem. But the fact is, you would really have to pounds and pounds of sugar would have to be fed in through the system. And at that point, it could be pounds and pounds of anything that you put into the fuel system to cause a problem. But the steel tank itself is supported to the underside of the vehicle by straps that almost look like a belt. And this is a cutaway section, and we can see the inside of the tank. And we see that there's a plastic well on the inside of the tank. Now, some people think that, you know, when the tank is running low on fuel, that there's a separate reserve section. But the thing is the pump actually draws from the bottom of the fuel tank, and it kind of uses this plastic well assembly right here to make sure that all of the remaining fuel is sort of funneled towards the bottom of the tank. That well is also part of a structure on the inside of the tank that prevents the gas from sloshing around. At any time, we don't want the pump to run out of fuel. If you're traveling on a hill or you park on an incline and the gas kind of sloshes to one side suddenly, there's a chance that the fuel, the pump, which is drawing off the bottom of the tank, could starve. It could cavitate, and it would actually suck air into the fuel system. If we get enough air in the fuel system, that will actually cause the pump to stall. The other thing which is really important, and this is a huge problem and a number one reason as to why fuel pumps fail, is that since the pump draws off the bottom of the tank, it actually uses the gasoline as a coolant and a lubricant for the electric pump motor. Yeah, that's right. This is an electric pump. It's an electric motor immersed in gasoline. The reason why it doesn't explode, even though there might be sparks, is because there's not enough fresh air in the tank to support combustion. It's just never going to happen. But if you run the tank low on fuel and that pump is constantly exposed to fuel vapor, it's a good chance that it's going to overheat because the vapor space is not a good coolant for the motor, and the pump motor at that point is going to get very noisy and it's going to fail. A number one reason why fuel pumps fail after people run out of gas, it's kind of a common misconception that maybe it sucked the debris off the bottom of the tank. Well, it's always sucking from the bottom of the tank, so the bottom of the tank is actually pretty clean. The problem is that when you ran the car extremely low on fuel, the pump overheated and burned out. Now, the way that we actually remove the pump from this older style fuel tank is there's a lock ring at the top here. I have three lines that come off here. I have a vapor line. This would go to a vapor recovery system. And then I have two lines. I have a pressure and a return line, and we'll talk about those a little bit later. And I have kind of the remnants here of an electrical connector too. Two of these wires would actually run the pump motor, power and ground, and the other two go back to my fuel gauge. Now, there's a float assembly in here that has an arm that goes up and down. As the arm goes up and down, it indicates the level of gas on the dashboard. Over here, I have a vapor line. As you put fuel into the car through the fill pipe, we have to have some way to actually allow the gas vapors to come back out. So this big hole right here, this is where our gas comes in, and then as the gas is filling up into the tank, the fuel vapor is going to be coming out of here, and that's going to allow this to fill up with fuel. Otherwise, the tank would blow up like a balloon. The other thing is as the gas level comes up, it's going to actually shut the pump off when it reaches this point. And that's going to leave me some airspace here on the top, and that's important because if the gas is cool and we drive the car, the gas might heat up due to the air temperature. Gas is going to expand and grow. We kind of need some headspace here on the top of the tank. And one thing that's a bad idea to do is to constantly try to, you know, once the pump shuts off when you're filling fuel, if you keep filling this with fuel, there's a chance that you could actually send liquid fuel out through this line, which is only meant for vapor. That could actually cause a problem with the emission system and cause a problem with the check engine light coming on or something like that. If there's any type of leak in the system, any of the vapor lines or any of the lines like that, there's a good chance also that our check engine light in the car will come on. That's why a lot of times when the check engine light comes on, the first thing people look for is the fuel cap. You just want to make sure that it's screwed on tight. The car actually goes through a self-test at night, and during that process, it pulls pressure on the fuel tank, and if it sees that the tank holds, it knows there's no leaks. If it sees the pressure and then the pressure's released, car figures out there must be a hole somewhere in the system, maybe in one of these seals, and at that point, it's going to turn on your check engine light. Okay, so let's take a look at what's involved with removing the style pump. Now, a couple things here. I'm going to put on some safety glasses. And I'm going to use a brass punch. Now, the brass punch is important because this is steel, and my hammer is steel. If I were to use a steel punch, there's a chance that I could have a spark occur. Obviously, if this was a live fuel tank, I wouldn't want that to happen. So I'm going to use a brass punch, which is going to make sure that I don't get any type of spark occurring. I'm going to knock this ring loose. Oops. And once the ring is knocked loose, the pump is actually loose here in the housing. And I kind of have a sort of a Rubik's Cube puzzle, if you will, trying to fish this out. Now, I don't want to cheat and reach my hand in here through the hole I made, but try to pull this pump out. It'd be a little difficult sometimes. There it goes. It would all come out this way. And this is actually the fuel pump for this particular car. This black part down here is the electric motor. This is a dampener. This is actually a fuel dampener that quiets the pump while it runs. And then this arm right here that goes up and down, this is my level indicator. So when the tank is full, the level's at the top. When I'm out of gas, it's all the way at the bottom. There's a little variable resistor right here that sends a signal back to the fuel gauge to tell you how much fuel is in the tank. Generally, if your fuel gauge doesn't work, chances are this little lever here has a hard life. It's immersed in gasoline, and this guy's always constantly going up and down. And what'll happen over time is you'll develop a break in the wiring here on your little level indicator, and then your fuel gauge doesn't work. All right, so to put this guy back in, I'm gonna make sure that my seal is at the top properly. I'm gonna position this back in, and again, I kinda have to go in the reverse fashion. Finagle this in. Make sure my seal is in place. And pop this guy down. And then I'm going to actually use the brass punch to knock that collar back into place. Like so, and that's pretty much what's involved with changing this style fuel pump. Now, again, it's important to remember that while I made it look really easy, if this tank had been full of fuel while I tried to do this, that would be time consuming. I'd have to siphon the fuel out, put it in a tank, separate tank to contain it. And more importantly, again, this type of tank, you can't get to this pump without actually dropping this tank from the car. So you need a lift, and you would have to, you know, disconnect all these fittings and everything. Some manufacturers, Asian import manufacturers and European manufacturers, actually give us an access cover to access this pump from within the car, and maybe later we'll take a look at that. Okay, next we're going to take a look at a more modern design, a plastic fuel tank. So, this is an example of a much more modern fuel tank design. Now, what's interesting about this tank is it is made of plastic rather than steel. That gives us some great advantages over the steel tanks. One is, namely, this doesn't rust. Two, it's lighter. Three, much like a rubber or plastic trash can, if you give this an impact, it will literally bounce back into shape, whereas the steel will dent and stay dented until we press it back into shape. The plastic that they use on these tanks is very similar to the plastic they actually make the plastic portable gas containers out of. But because this system has to remain sealed for emissions reasons, there's actually two layers of plastic that they use. They use an outer, more durable layer, and then they use an inner layer, which is actually has a very tight molecular bond, so none of the fuel particles, the hydrocarbons, actually seep through the plastic. Several years ago, certain manufacturers tried plastic tanks and they worked well, but they found out that in the long run, those tanks actually leached some of the gas fumes. It would actually seep through the molecular bonds of the plastic. It wouldn't cause a fluid leak, you wouldn't smell it, but you know, measured over a certain amount of time, too much material left, and we've consequently come up with this neat double tank design. Other things about this is that this tank is accessible through the back seat. If you look at the shape of this, this is kind of about where, you know, in the back seat, this might be where your derriere kind of sits, and this would be the center of the car. So by removing the back seat, we're able to get to this pump, which is a great advantage. We don't have to drop this tank down for service. Which reminds me, let me show you what's involved in taking this tank out, the pump out for service. When it comes to removing a more modern typical fuel pump, you'll notice that they've done away with the lock ring assembly that you hit with a hammer. This actually, we might use a special wrench to actually tighten this guy down. And you'll also notice that there's only one fuel outlet on this, and that is because this system is a returnless fuel system. And when we talk about fuel systems a little bit more in depth, I'll explain the difference. This connector right here on the top, this is where I would get my power and ground from my pump, and again, where I would send my signal back to the dashboard for the fuel gauge. This guy comes out much, much easier. Just basically take this ring off, and then you can pull out the entire pump in one piece, and they call this a pump module, is the modern name for it. And it kind of comes out here like that, and then this is my entire pump module. Now, This has a nice plastic rubber seal around the inside of it. And of course, now I can completely see down inside the tank very easily. Again, this is my level, my float, and there's my little sensor, my fuel level sensor. What's neat about this design is, as complicated as this looks, the fact is I can actually have this sit in different varying height vehicles. So, you know, as a manufacturer, from a manufacturer standpoint, this one pump can actually fit several different types of fuel tanks. The other thing is that as this plastic expands and contracts, I want to make sure that this pump stays in constant contact with the bottom of the tank again. That's where it picks up the fuel from. So as the tank kind of moves and grows and expands, this, you know, pump will expand and contract with the actual tank as it grows. The pump itself is this part right here, and it is possible to change just the pump or just the level indicator if they fail. At that point, you have to think about this, and if I'm taking all of this out and there's any question that the pump has somehow failed before or something like that, you might want to decide to just do both at the same time rather than just fix one and then have the other component, the pump, fail later down the road. So put this guy back in for now. Drop this back in. Oops, forgot my seal. Don't want to forget that. That guy back on like that, snug that down. If you are going to do this yourself, again, please be very careful because you are dealing with fuel. You want to make sure that you note the position of the sending unit and the fuel feed, and there might even be marks indicating exactly when this you should stop tightening this ring. Manufacturer actually put a little yellow mark right here that tells me that that's the proper tension that this collar should be set to. If I over tighten this, I really, really over tighten this, there's a chance that I could actually crack this or damage the seal or gasket down in there. And that's going to lead to a fuel leak later down the road when I'm servicing the vehicle or putting fuel in it. This area underneath the seat of the car would possibly leak fuel and cause a check engine light and, you know, worse, cause a gas smell inside the car. All right, so let's move on from our fuel system, from the tank and the pumps, to take a look at some of the other components in our fuel system. Before we move on to the modern fuel injection, I wanted to just kind of touch back here real quickly on what we came from. And this is a carburetor. Carburetor was a really complicated way to meter fuel at different rates into the engine. And the problem with carburetors was that they were extremely mechanically complex. There's you know, levers and springs and small screws to turn and that kind of thing. And they were really, they got to the point where they were just too finicky. And the problem was is they would fail. They would fail fairly often. And they were very mechanically complex, so they were very labor intensive to work with, and really took a true skilled technician to actually service these. The biggest downfall was that the fuel going into the car could not really be controlled. We sort of just pumped it through pipes at varying rates, and we hoped our math was right. But the fact is one of those pipes clogged or something like that, the car ran really badly, and oftentimes it led to polluting the atmosphere. So we went to fuel injection, and that was one of the big benefits. The other thing is that the carburetor, you know, would sit on top, it would suck air in, we would pump our fuel into it, and the air and fuel would have to mix in the carburetor, and then it would kind of atomize as it traveled through these ports right here, and this would connect to our cylinder head. So it was almost like the, you know, the door to let the air and fuel in was way in the back of the room, and we actually wanted to get the people to the front of the room. So there's lots of turbulence and tumbling and sludge that would build up in these things, and you know, they were just so mechanically complex that we had, you know, we eventually had to give up on them and went to electronic fuel injection. Now, the reason why some people still really like carburetors is the fact that, well, there's very few wires on this thing. But the trade-off is all those wires are replaced with screws and linkage and things like that that bind up and get dirty and can be messed with, and then the vehicle doesn't run well. So you got to put this away. The system so far that we've talked about is, you know, this is a whole modern fuel injection system. So we've talked about the fuel tank at this point, and we've talked about the fuel pump and the fuel level sensor, and then we have the fuel line that comes out, and our next component in line typically is a fuel filter. Now, I've changed fuel filters before here on the show, but I don't think I've ever actually cut one apart and shown you how they work on the inside. This is a fuel filter, and the filter media that it uses is very similar to a thick coffee filter. Filters down to about 10 microns, which is about the size of the smallest piece of dust the naked eye can see. And fuel comes in here on this side, and then it hits this metal diaphragm, and then it washes over the filter and then passes through to the inside. The gasoline passes through to the inside, the dirt stays on the outside, and then it passes through this outlet. Now obviously, if this filter becomes clogged in some way, it's going to stop the flow of fuel up to the car. So there's a chance that if the car stalls, the filter could be faulty. But if the car runs and it has fuel pressure and things like that, the filter is probably not the problem. You'll change your fuel filter according to the manufacturer's recommendations for service intervals. Some cars it's 30,000, other cars it's 100,000. Some cars, actually the filter is part of the pump now, so it's considered a lifetime filter, and this actually isn't a needed component anymore, but again, you have to check with the manufacturer to see if that's the case. So we'll put our fuel filter away. And the final component that we have with our fuel injection system is the injection manifold. And this is pretty much where the fuel comes out. The fuel is going to be piped into one of these lines. It's going to then be distributed through to each injector, and then it winds back through a pressure regulator and is actually sent back to the tank. Now, the fact that the fuel is sent through a loop, it's sent up, and what isn't used is sent back to the tank, is actually a good thing. What it allows the fuel to do is actually stay cool while the car is running, and the higher pressures that the modern fuel injection runs at actually prevents a problem which carburetors used to have, which was called vapor lock. Vapor lock is the process in which the fuel actually starts to boil and evaporate inside these fuel lines. Modern fuel injection vehicles typically run anywhere between about maybe 30 to 60 pounds of pressure, and that high pressure actually keeps that fuel from boiling. The other thing is that higher fuel pressure is actually able to knock the bubbles out of the way and actually push them through the fuel system, and the car continues to run. When we had a carbureted fuel system, those vehicles ran at about 3 to 5 psi, and if you ended up with a bunch of air bubbles blocking an air line, the car wouldn't start. You had to manually get out and crack the fuel line open and bleed that pressure bubble out before you had any chance of getting the car to run. So things like vapor lock, which went along with carburetors, is something that we haven't had for 30 years now because we've had fuel injection for so long. So there's no more carburetors in cars, and we've replaced the carburetor with the fuel injection. And you notice that there is electrical wires, but there's really no more moving parts. There's no more screws to turn. There's no more springs to really bind up. There is a component not shown here called a throttle body, which may have a spring on it, but it's basically just a big flapper door attached to the gas pedal. So let's see what's involved to take one of these things apart. I'm going to first remove these electrical connectors, and that's because my fuel injectors are electric. Pop these guys off here.
This guy's a little sticky.
All right, so there's my fuel injection harness right here. Each one of these yellow connectors is power and ground to each individual injector. The injectors themselves are like a solenoid. They're just a magnetic field of wire that when we apply voltage, they open, allowing pressurized fuel to flow through them. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to actually take them off this fuel rail so you can see them up close. Now, our fuel rail, which is this part right here, is held on with these three Torx bits. Once I take them off, the injectors are actually wedged between the fuel rail and this part of the lower manifold. Now, fuel injectors are actually really susceptible to dirt, and I'll show you why. The holes on the end of the injector are so small that you almost can't see them, and I'm not sure if the camera's going to pick them up, so I might have to kind of try to take a still image and show it to you. But you know, when we're talking about the fuel filter filtering down to 10 microns in size, that's because we literally can't let any piece of dirt or grit or sand or anything enter the fuel injectors. It's enough to actually clog them from working. That's how fine the holes are. Okay, so pop this guy off. One more here. Okay, so these are the injectors as they come out. Again, there's my lower half of my intake. Now, the injectors themselves right here, this part actually sprays on the backside of the intake valve. And the fuel is controlled in such a way that when the intake valve is starting to open, that's when this guy is commanded to spray it a little shot of fuel. What happens is as this is spraying and we're opening that intake valve, we actually create a low pressure cell inside our combustion chamber, and that actually takes our liquid fuel in the line. It's atomized as it comes through the little teeny tiny holes here, and then it's actually vaporized as it's sucked into the cylinder. So we really get a very, very good mixture of our air to fuel ratio. Again, going back to the problems with carburetors, that process just didn't happen. So carburetors by their nature just were less efficient, and they weren't as powerful, and they were not as reliable as modern fuel injection. Let me pull an injector off. We'll see if we can see the little insides of it. Whoops. Pull this guy out. There we go, and there's our fuel injector out. Now, try to zoom in close. That's our electrical connector right there on the injector. This top part here is an O-ring, and it's a replaceable rubber seal. And all the way on the inside of this guy, there's actually another little teeny tiny filter basket, which is like the world's smallest coffee filter, and it's the last line of defense for the fuel injector. The fuel is under pressure as it's sent through here, and then we send our power and ground through here. When that happens, there's a pintle on the inside. Normally, when this doesn't have power, the pintle is closed. When we apply voltage, the pintle pulls up and it allows pressurized fuel to meter through the injector, and then our pressurized fuel comes out through this little teeny tiny hole. Look on the inside there. I don't know if you can see it, but there's actually five very tiny holes that are probably about the size of a pinhead. And that's where all of our fuel comes out through that cylinder. So if there's any thing clogging the end of this injector, fuel doesn't flow and the car doesn't run. So Let's see, that's the fuel system all the way up to the injector assembly. Let's take a look at a couple of the tools that we're going to use to actually figure out the fuel system. So one of the first tools that we have to check our fuel system is a fuel pressure test gauge. Now this is a really, really critical component. This gauge actually ties into the fuel system. Some cars use a threaded adapter, other cars use like a T-fitting. But it's going to tell me exactly how much pressure the fuel pump is putting out. Now, when you have a car that doesn't run, checking fuel pressure is a key thing, because if the car has no fuel pressure, it's never going to run. I mean, car needs air, fuel, and spark to run. And the pressure part is the fuel part of that equation. So a fuel pressure test gauge is a very, very necessary tool when you're diagnosing a car that you suspect has a fuel injection problem. The next component we have is this little clear light bulb assembly. This is called a noid light, which is short for solenoid. And what the noid light does is you actually take the light and you plug it into the injection harness. And if the light lights up while you're cranking the car, that's an indication that that injector is getting power and ground. And so that's a very useful tool to tell me if the wiring from the injector all the way back to the computer, if that wiring is okay, or if the computer is sending out the right signal. So this is a really, really useful tool. And again, very necessary. The last piece that we have is this little guy. This is a fuel injection tester. And basically what this is a device that hooks up to a fuel injector one at a time. I have it hooked up to a battery pack with some alligator clips. But it allows you to actually run the fuel injector without having the car turned on. Now this is important because these injectors, when they function, they actually make a little sound. They click on and off. And I'll hold this near the microphone so you can hear it, but that's the sound the injector makes. If you hear that sound, there's a good chance that the injector itself physically is okay, and that it would probably allow fuel to flow through. So if we try this brown injector, which is off another car, they're all very similar. If we try this brown one, tell me if the brown one's good. Yeah, it's making noise, it sounds okay. And let's try this yellow one. Let's see if this yellow injector is any good. What do you think? You hear anything? Nope, means the injector's no good. So, you know, while you can have a car with good fuel pressure and a good signal, the fact is the injector itself may have actually failed. Now, one failed fuel injector isn't going to keep the car from running, but it will cause an emissions problem and cause a major misfire. So those are just some of the tools that we can use to check a fuel injection system. What I got behind me is a 1997 Subaru Legacy wagon, and it currently doesn't run. It's cranks, so the engine turns over, but it doesn't start, so it doesn't actually start and run. And we're going to take a look at the fuel system on it. Okay, so our Subaru does not start. Now, one of the first steps in a no-start diagnosis would be to look and see that there's enough fuel in the car, and the fuel gauge shows that it's about a quarter tank full, so I know the car isn't empty. The other thing is, there's a few other things I could check, but a fuel system check is a pretty quick and easy check. And on this particular vehicle, this is where the fuel filter is located. It's in a really easily accessible spot. This line in the back here, this comes from our fuel pump. It's then filtered and then sent down here through our injector assembly on the vehicle. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to undo this clamp, and I'm going to install our fuel pressure test gauge. Now, this is a slightly older vehicle design, and some vehicles have an easier way to attach a fuel pressure gauge than others. This one is a little more on the complicated side, but just bear with me and we'll get through it. Now, it's important to mention that if the fuel system is functioning, there could be pressurized fuel in this rail. And if that's the case, it's going to come out. Now, it's going to be under a lot of pressure, but because the car isn't running, there's not going to be a lot of volume behind it. Even if the system's not functioning, I'm probably going to get some fuel out of here, but you have to realize the fact that there's some fuel in here doesn't necessarily mean it works. That's a mistake a lot of people make, is they assume that there's fuel here and that must be enough to make the car run, but the fact is the car needs quite a bit of pressure and volume to actually make the car run. Yep, and there's our fuel dripping off there. Again, some people would look at that and say, hey, it must be fine, I got gas there. You don't have enough. So I'm going to set up our test adapter on here. So I'm installing this T connection, which is going to allow me to install a fuel pressure test gauge. And what I'm going to do is try to start the car again and see if there is any fuel pressure. Now this pressure gauge reads from about 0 to 100 PSI. What I'm going to look for when I go to start the vehicle is that if I turn the key on, and this jumps to about 30, chances are I have good fuel pressure. The car at that point, you know, would indicate that it has good fuel and that's not the reason why the car isn't starting. So I'm going to go and place this right here and go crank the car and see what I get. Yep, no fuel pressure. So that's the reason why this vehicle is not running. The fuel pump isn't delivering any fuel to the injector assembly. Now, what I'm going to do at this point is take a look at some wiring diagrams, check some fuses, because the fuel pump will have a fuse and a relay to make sure it's functioning properly. I'm going to check those things out, and we'll see what we come up with. We're here at the fuel cap for the vehicle, and you know, this is the service point for the vehicle fuel system on the consumer side, and you can see that this fuel cap is probably pretty common in the sense of the amount of trash and debris that kind of builds up in the pocket of the fuel door. Now, if you remember from the show on detailing, if you saw that, I actually like to clean this area out because every time you do open and close the fuel cap off the vehicle, some of that dirt and debris does fall inside the tank. And of course, that's why there's the filter system, because we want to prevent any of that debris from reaching the fuel injectors. The gas cap itself is actually a pretty complicated piece of equipment. The cap itself is actually a pressure release and vacuum prevention device. As the fuel level drops in the car, we would build up a vacuum inside the fuel tank. That would create a fuel starvation issue for the injectors and the engine. So as the fuel level drops, we actually have to allow some fresh air into the tank. Now, you know, there is some fresh air in the tank, but it's not enough to cause a problem with the fuel pump. But the other thing is that there's holes on the back side of the cap, and some of these holes allow that fresh air to come in. Of course, the opposite may happen, where if we park the car someplace where there's actually a lot of high ambient temperature, maybe you fill the car up the night before and then you drive to a shopping mall, and you drive into a very sunny, hot spot in the shopping mall in the summertime, and the ambient temperature of the parking lot might be 120 degrees. That heat's going to radiate up into our fuel tank and actually cause our fuel to expand. Now, the cap is supposed to seal the system off along with the rest of the evaporative emission components, but in the event that there was a tremendous pressure buildup, maybe over 1 or 2 psi, this cap is actually designed to vent as a safety vent, much like a radiator cap, and actually prevent those gases from building up to the point where we balloon or rupture our fuel tank. So the gas cap plays an important part. The tether, this plastic cable here, is also important because what this prevents is from people losing their gas cap. The fact that we prevent the gas cap loss is kind of a win-win for the customer in the sense that not only do they not leave their fuel cap at the gas station when they go to get fuel, but we also make sure that we don't drive around without a gas cap. And anytime that we drive around without a fuel cap, we're getting some of those hydrocarbon vapors evaporating. Not only are you actually losing your fuel, but you're actually polluting the air. You're creating photochemical smog at that point when we release all those fuel vapors. So the cap and the tether, they actually go together important with the car. And that's also why when we do an emissions inspection, we check the fuel cap to make sure that it seals properly and that it's able to completely close off the fuel system. Down on the inside here of the filler neck, this is our, you know, where we're going to service our vehicle. If you have a vehicle where you suspect that the fuel pump isn't running like this car, it's a good idea to actually take a funnel and put it into the vehicle. Now, this isn't to pour some fuel in. What we're going to use this as is actually like an amplifier. If at this point I listen and I try to hear if the fuel pump is running when somebody cycles the key on and off, just by turning the car on, the pump should run for about 2 seconds. If I don't hear that, there's a good chance that the fuel pump is actually not functioning in the car, and I know that I have a fuel pump problem. The other thing is that when it comes to putting gas in the car, if you actually run out of fuel on the road, it's important to make sure that you try to get as much fuel as you can into the car and not spilling all over the place. This size nozzle right here is the size of an unleaded size fuel nozzle. The actual larger diameter of the fuel system was originally for a regular sized fuel nozzle. Back in the 1980s when we sold regular leaded fuel, the nozzle itself was bigger. Manufacturers had to put in this fuel inlet restrictor, and this is another component that we check for when we do a state inspection, is to make sure that that little flap is in place. You got to be careful though, because of that little flap, you want to make sure that anything that you put in, if it's anything like a flexible hose or anything like that, it'll actually get caught on that fuel inlet restrictor and cause a problem. So now that we've come to the conclusion that it's most likely a fuel pump issue, we're going to come right here to the fuel pump. Now, in this particular vehicle, we're lucky because we can actually access the fuel pump from inside the vehicle. Now, in some other vehicles, mostly domestic products, generally you actually have to take the whole tank down from the underside of the car, and that's quite a big mess, especially if the tank is full of fuel. However, with most Asian import or European vehicles, a lot of times the manufacturer actually puts an access cover in the floor that allows us to get to the pump connector, the sending unit, and also the wiring, and then we can also remove the pump. Now, I'm not going to remove the pump in this car just yet. If I were, after I take the cover off, I would get maybe a large plastic trash bag or something like that, because when I pull that pump out, it's going to be dripping fuel all over my carpeting inside the car. If that happens, gasoline being the smelly product as it is, this car will smell like a gas station probably for months, even after all the fuel dries up, because it literally gets saturated back into the plastic of the carpeting. So let's take a look here. I'm going to take my access cover off and swing this out of the way. And right here, this is my pump cover. Now, this is held on with four screws, and it's got a little soft foam insulation here to kind of help keep it weather sealed and also help dampen some of the noise down. But when I take the pump cover off, we'll see what we find. All right, so here we see our fuel pump connector, and the connector's right there, and it looks to be, well, I think I might actually see a problem here. But I can also see my other fuel lines. I have a vent line, a pressure line, and a return line here. And the good news is they're all dry. There's no leaks under here. If there were leaks, there's a possibility that I could smell fuel in the car as I was driving or as I was filling it up. But I think I see the problem, which it looks like this fuel pump connector right here, it looks like this ground wire, according to my schematic, is pulled out. So I'm going to plug this back in, and then we'll see if this guy runs our pump. And in that case, I'm really lucky, because that's all that was that prevented this car from starting. I don't know if somebody ran a test here at one point, or maybe it just wasn't plugged in all the way. Let's plug that back in. I'm going to put this cover back on, and we'll see what we find. All right, so now that we've fixed that ground on the fuel pump, we're going to take a look again at the pressure gauge. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to turn the key to the on position. I'm not going to start the car. I'm just going to turn the key on. And I should, at that point, probably hear the fuel pump run now, and I should get pressure on the gauge. So I'll turn the key. Let's see here, what do we got? Yep, I definitely have fuel pressure now. Fans are cycling, that's fine. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna start and run this and see what we have. Well, there we go. Obviously that ground was the problem with our fuel system. Got good fuel pressure, car fired right up. And I think that about does it. I'm going to disconnect this fuel pressure test gauge and go for a test drive. I'm Dan Reed. Thanks for watching Car Corner. Drive safely.
Rolling all the time.
How's the light?
Hi, and welcome to Car Corner. My name's Richard Saxton. I'm the coordinator of the automotive program here at the Community College of Philadelphia. I'm the blabba-dabba.
Yeah, look at that. Delicious, delicious taffy. It's delicious taffy.